Hi everyone, my name is Suma and here's Andreas Müller. He's based in Germany and he gives talks on non-duality. Welcome, Andreas.
Hello, thank you very much.
Thank you so much for doing this, Andreas. I really appreciate this opportunity. I've heard so many good things about you. I'm really excited about
it. Wow. Cool. Yeah, great.
I was thinking it would be nice to first begin with your spiritual seeking days. I would love to hear more about your spiritual seeking days, how you began and what motivated you towards spiritual seeking.
Well, it depends on how to tell the story. I think in one way it started in my youth, so to speak, when I was around 15, 16, I somehow stumbled into taking all kind of substances. And I basically did this for a few years. And this had a big impact on me, actually right away in the beginning, because I was so, very simply spoken, I was just so impressed by how good I can feel taking stuff. I was just impressed how, as I said, how good I can feel. So taking stuff somehow already immediately had kind of a spiritual aspect to me. But after a few years, this didn't really work anymore. So I took stuff, but it didn't have the same impact on me. So I quit this whole period of life and then replaced it with spirituality, basically. There was a bit of healing in it. And then I was following a spiritual teacher, I would say, who, for quite a few years. And this all had also aspects of healing and being here and now and feel your feelings and don't go into the story, stuff like that. Not really, there wasn't much esoteric stuff going on, but that's basically what I did and what my life was about.
Do you feel there was a possibility maybe you replaced the substance things with spiritual?
Absolutely. Oh, in the end, it was just a replacement. Totally. Totally. And I got aware of that a few years after the spiritual thing began, that actually I was just looking for that feelings or states that I got from the substances. I wanted to have that. But being sober, so to speak. Yeah.
So your main goal for spiritual seeking was that feeling, that state of mind.
Exactly. Just to feel really, really good and somehow really free. I wanted to feel boundless. I liked that when I took the substances, so to speak, to not be involved with my story and to have this really energetic, full on, no limits feeling. And somehow I wanted to have that as my ordinary state of mind or state of life. That was my idea. Yeah.
And what were, did you have any strong concepts about back then? Did you have strong ideas about what enlightenment looks like? What an enlightened person looks like?
Yeah, I mean, that changed all the time in a way. Sometimes I thought it's more like that. It's more like subtle contentment. Sometimes I thought it must feel like total bliss and stuff like that. But I think I was really much more interested in having this experience. I wasn't very theoretical, like I wanted enlightenment and I wanted to be someone. No, I somehow had the expectation that it must really it must be really sensible and my reality.
And from what I read, it seems like this happened in 2009. Was it like a one moment, or do you think like it was like a gradual thing for you?
Well, no, I would say the gradual thing happened in 2009. So I had an awakening, so to speak, where there clearly wasn't anyone there. And from that point on, this whole spiritual game somehow crumbled energetically. It was not a logical thing, but somehow this hole in the story, this not being someone, was a bit like a slap in the face, so to speak. And after that, this spiritual game crumbled. And in this crumbling, I met Tony Parsons. And then there was a slow fading out for 2 years, so to speak, until 2011, one could say.
Isn't it interesting, like, although this thing kind of falls into the spiritual circle, this is so, this is actually, it crumbles down the spiritual game, like it's, and it's, although it's perceived strongly like that, like this is something spiritual, this is about becoming enlightenment.
Yeah. Oh, totally, it's very interesting. It's in a way, the death of the seeker, no matter from which background the seeking comes. I think the connection to spirituality often is that spirituality makes that claim, so to speak, that it's about that. So in spirituality, you often get the same concepts and ideas because they think it's about whatever, it's about liberation and all those things, but they dance around those concepts. So this is why it may look very close, or the same even.
Were there like some things that you did before with regards to spiritual healing or spiritual teachers that didn't resonate with you anymore when that seeing happened for you? Or was it still, did that thing still continued on as part of the story?
Well, I don't really know what you mean, but I think in terms of practices or stuff like that.
Yes.
No, actually not. No, not really. I didn't have such a clear practice, or my whole practice was kind of more like inside, you know, playing around with awareness and not going into thoughts. That basically crumbled. So there was nothing really left. I didn't have a strict plan, like 1 hour meditation in the morning and then 1 hour of reciting mantras or whatever. So I never really had that. So there was nothing to crumble.
And were there any apparent changes to the person?
That's hard to say. Not really, of course. Not really, of course. But it's both. Nothing really changes. I didn't change. Andreas, the functioning, the conditioning didn't really change. But of course, when there is no sense of lack anymore, or when there is no sense of this isn't it, I have to find something, when this isn't anymore, in a subtle way, this also changes, of course. So yes and no. But it's much more, but the changing is much more ordinary and normal and subtle than, it's not overnight, like suddenly you're a totally different person or something.
So it was not like some kind of a full-blown spiritual experience or something. It was
Yes. In the end, this is my story, that it's a bit like this slow fading out, of course, without noticing that I'm fading out. In that time, I had a completely different story about myself, because as long as there is someone, it feels like I'm on a path. And my story at that time was that things get lighter and life is more easy and I don't care that much anymore. Still thinking that I'm moving into a future which is still better, which is a little bit closer and stuff. And so the collapse, the apparent collapse, was actually a non-event. I wasn't waiting for it. It was not a big thing. It wasn't even an it. There was no event actually at all. There was just suddenly, so to speak, no one there anymore. But I can't explain that.
Is there a kind of like a side effect of relaxation, I assume, because like being the me, like trying to always seek for something, it's a very tensed energy, like even without realizing, it can be kind of like a tensed experience where you're always trying to find something, even when listening to some talks or, did you have like a side effect of relaxation where that was gone because the seeking is gone, now it's more?
Yeah, one could say so, yes. But I would turn the picture a little bit around, because it's not really that the relaxation is a side effect. It's more like that being someone has a lot of side effects, like being tense, like living in stories, like wanting to find something else. And in a way, one could say what happens is that those side effects stop. So it's not really that an additional state of relaxation comes in, but of course there is a relaxing aspect in that, because of course it's like, not for someone. But of course the end of this whole setup is like, energetically.
And I also think that the way the me is set up, it can be quite clever, because it tries to engage you in some really clever stories, like this is the last thing I need to know and then I'll be liberated, this is the last thing I need and I'll be free, and it keeps you waiting on and on, and it has some really clever way of like coming up with those nuances. Can you comment on the nature of me?
Yes, I mean, on the one hand, one could say it's clever. On the other hand, seen from the person, it's the only possibility. Because seen, the only possibility for the person, so to speak, is to be the person. And of course, it has to approach everything from a personal standpoint. And so what it's looking for is an answer. What it's looking for is the truth, so to speak. What it's looking for is this one thing which answers everything. And this message can seem like that. So the person just somehow suddenly, yes, maybe this is it. And that's what I mean. It's not necessarily clever. It's just how it approaches everything. And now it approaches this message, non-message, like that.
In your personal apparent story? Did you have any such things that were going on where that was keeping you in that like lock-in?
Well, of course, kind of. That's what I mean. Until the end, so to speak, there was someone who was somehow living in stories and stuff like that. But I think the most intense things like that I had in my spiritual phase, because this was already where I thought, this is the answer, this is it, this will give me everything, I will become a totally happy person. And when that crumbled, so to speak, I couldn't really redo it with this message again. It was almost ridiculous to have those same thoughts again. Because before that, there already was so much admiration and stories around having found and being on the right path. So it didn't really happen with this message again. At least not so total. Of course, as I said, as long as there was someone, there were stories about me and about life and stuff like that.
Sometimes I feel like the spiritual stories can be a lot more difficult to get out of than the regular me, because some of these spiritual stories can be quite intense. Like you have to clean up your blockages to become enlightened, and you have to be a better person. Like there are some really strong stories.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, my impression is it's just really loaded with meaning. You know, it's always about, for someone, about absolute love and absolute freedom and total healing. And it's all those ideas which, seen from the person, can be loaded with so much importance and meaning. It's somehow, it's a bit like, easy to understand that a new car doesn't make you happy, so to speak, or being rich isn't everything what life is about. But if you have these fluid ideas where you can actually project all kinds of things into, like absolute bliss, unconditional freedom for someone, then that can become really heavy and intense for the person. And it's hard to, you know, in the end, also with money, for example, you know, if you have 100 euros or dollars, or if you have 100 millions, but with this emotional, spiritual thing, it's just one moment you feel blissful and 5 minutes later something bad happens and you feel totally bad. And this connected with those meaningful ideas of I'll be enlightened soon, or I will never get it. That's a roller coaster.
Another strong story is about the story about oneness, how oneness looks like. That's I feel like, ironically, it doesn't allow it's kind of like it tries to uniform things and not under the blanket of oneness, and not, and also like creating strong ideas about how oneness looks like.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I wanted to ask you about this next question is about this is mostly among the speakers in non-duality or teachers in non-duality. It seems like maybe it's the style of communication, but it creates like a sense of like it for some new people it's an intimidating message. It kind of like scares them a bit because being know me, or like the idea of death, like there are strong misinterpretations that can happened. Did you want to say something about that, like how this can be actually like very scary for some people when, if they listen to it for the first time?
Yes, of course. And in a way, one could say when they are scared, they kind of immediately know what it's about, which is death in the end. So, yes, that's just what it is. For this illusion to be someone, it is threatening. Energetically, it's not the words really. I mean, of course, some people are scared by the concept of death or stuff like that. But in a way, it's constant. No, it's not constantly. It's immediately, inherently, so to speak, pointed to one's absence or to one's not being real, which is kind of seen from the person. It's like pointing to death, and it just can feel like that. So yes, that happens.
But it seems like there is a tendency for this to create more misunderstanding like that. Why not also present the idea of like there is nothing, but there is also an apparent something, and present that paradox? Because usually it seems like there is more tendency to talk about nothing versus like talking about the paradox.
I don't know if that's the case in my case, so to speak. I think maybe it is, I'm not sure, maybe it is like that, but I wouldn't say so, to be honest. I think it's just what comes across energetically for the person. I understand that it can be perceived like that, and I don't count, so to speak, how often I say nothing and how often I say it's everything and stuff like that. But my assumption is the person would be threatened anyway, because the threat is rather energetic than because of the concepts that we are playing with. That's my impression.
And when you give these talks, does it happen often that the message gets heard, or is it still quite rare?
Yeah. In the end, it's quite rare, so to speak, but not as rare as the person might think, so to speak. It's not one in 10 years or something. It happens. The apparent death happens, or the apparent obviousness of what's being spoken about here does happen. It's not totally rare.
What's the most common question you get asked at these talks?
Well, I don't know really, but in the end, it's one. It's just one question, disguised in many questions, so to speak. The question is, how can I become one? Or the question is, what can I do? What's the right way for me to be in order to become one? Shall I do this? Shall I do that? Shall I be like that? Shall I be like that? What to do? Please help me. What can I do? I think that's the one question, basically, that's asked. That's the seeker asks. That's the person asks constantly.
How do you answer that question? That seems like a very difficult question.
Well, that's the dilemma, that it's exactly to this question. There is no answer. I can't answer this question, or there is no answer to this question, one could say. And that's the person's dilemma, so to speak. It experienced itself as I'm here, and it's a bit like shouting into space, well, why am I here? What shall I do? And there's just nothing coming back, ever. So there is no answer.
Does that trigger frustration for people?
Of course, there is frustration, but there's also freedom in it. Because what's also implied energetically is that there is no answer needed, so to speak. But of course, it's frustrating for the seeker within the this apparent world of the seeker. This is frustrating, but there's also some relief in it. On the one hand, because there just is no answer. It's not another concept or idea. And it relieves from the possibility to be right or wrong.
Before I couldn't see it, but now I can kind of see like the irony of like when some teachers try to prescribe a practice, like you should you can meditate or something. It's like, again, creating more concepts. Like if you meditate, you are a better person. If you don't meditate, you're not doing anything. And it's creating more and more complications.
At least it's perpetuating it. At least it's just confirming the personal setup.
And do you ever have situations where maybe some listeners get angry because they can't do anything about it?
Hardly, actually. Actually, that doesn't happen. I don't know why. Maybe it's because everyone already saw a video and they don't even come anymore. You know, they clicked away at home on YouTube. But no. I actually think because it's not a personal message. It's not, this message doesn't try to confront people. It doesn't create an opposite standpoint. It's not in opposition to something really. So, of course, for some people it is intense and there are strong reactions and maybe some people get a bit angry inside or something. But I think it's quite obvious that it's not trying to, that it's not in war. This message is not in war with anything.
It's not trying to convince anything.
Exactly. It doesn't have a direction it's not fighting against something. Like, for example, in a teaching where you fight unhappiness or you fight against illusion or stuff like that. It doesn't do that.
Is it getting easier for you to talk about this topic now than you used to before, maybe like 10 years ago when you started?
Yes, I would say so. Yes. Yes. Yeah. I mean, the thing is, I'm just doing a lot of talks and I'm just getting a lot of questions. But in the beginning, so to speak, it's still the same today. I have to be careful here. Not careful, but I mean, in the beginning, that's the thing. The picture of the person is when you are no one, you suddenly know it all, as if you now know all the sentences and how it is and stuff like that. But in the end, it's the other way around. When the person dies, one doesn't know anything anymore. So it's blank. And when I started the talks, it was not that I had something to say. In the beginning, when I started the talks, I tried to prepare a little bit of sentences, what I could say and stuff. And usually I couldn't have more than two sentences in my head. I couldn't get it together. And it's the same today. It's not that now I know what I want to say. It's still blank, but I'm somehow more used to that. It was very weird in the beginning it still kind of is, to invite people to come. In the beginning, it was at my home, without having anything to say or to share or...
And about this next question, I know this is a futile attempt, but if you had to describe freedom, how would you describe?
Yes, you are right. That's a mean question. Well, that the freedom in the end is that there is no such thing. That's the freedom, that everything already is free to be as it is, but that's not a state that can be described. In the end, it's exactly that, what is the freedom, that it's not a state that I'm in, and that it's not in a certain way, that freedom is not in a certain way opposed to other ways. I think it's exactly that's the freedom. Which, as I said, it's not even the freedom. Everything is just naturally free to be what it is, basically. There isn't anything saying no to anything. Neither a person nor a God. There is no one taking care. That's the freedom. That's the absolute freedom, so to speak. And it's already the case. It's not a state that one day will be achieved or that will happen one day. It's already absolutely free. So it's this, having a Zoom talk, being you, being me, watching this, that's it. That's the perfect picture of freedom, so to speak.
And not allowing is also allowed. Not being free is also
exactly allowed. Yes, exactly. In that sense, one could also turn it around and say, everything is absolutely bound to be what it is. There is no. It's free to be what it is, but there's also no other possibility or no choice. There's also no one choosing. So in a way, it's also totally bound to be what it is. It's both. But for no one, that's what this message is saying, that there isn't anyone imprisoned into what happens. And there's always also no one who will be free from what happens.
Does it happen with you when you're giving talks or speaking? Even if you have a clear message, it's sometimes difficult to pierce through the reality of me It will get processed as some kind of concept. Even if you don't say anything sometimes, maybe.
That's the thing, yes. It will be, seen from the person, it will be processed as a concept anyway. Absolutely. Even if I don't say anything, the person will go on living with concepts about the world and how it is and what the truth is, and about me, it would say, I don't know, there's this sentence around silence is the highest teaching, so they would even turn the silence into it and stuff like that. Well, for the first part, what you said in the first part, is it difficult to come through? No, it's never difficult, because that's not the intention or the attempt. I don't even attempt to have an effect. There is no intention in creating an effect over there or in the listener. I'm just saying what I say, regardless, so to speak, or there are just the words that come out. It's not even that I say them. There's just what happens. So there's just what comes out, regardless of anyone hearing it, not hearing it, it having an effect, it not having an effect, of people weaving more stories and beliefs out of it. There's no expectation at all about what should happen, what's supposed to happen. No. Last one said, and as I said, it's inevitable anyway. So the person will make up another concept. It already has concepts. It's not really that it's implying that it's adding more stuff. No, the person will just replace an old concept with a new one, but the person would do that anywhere, no matter what it would be doing.
Sorry, I didn't mean to say that you are trying to convince something or explain something. I was more pointing to, like, for example, even if you are quiet, it could get processed as if, this means this person is really quiet and silent. That means he must know something. He must really have the ultimate knowledge.
Absolutely, totally. If the seeker is settled in the belief that I am a special someone, I could probably do anything, and the seeker would still try to confirm its picture of he is special. Totally. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Can't help it. No matter I would say I'm normal. I'm not. Yeah. Of course. But in a way, this also happens all the time, because the basis of all that is just assuming me to be someone who is something, rich, poor, clever, dumb, enlightened, not enlightened. So in a way, it's also just what the person, the illusion of being a person, does anyway, seeing people who are in positions. And if that's what happens, it's inevitable as well. I could do anything. And seen from the person, this wouldn't be destroyed. Maybe I could, maybe if I behave totally off, the seeker may not believe, no, he's not enlightened. But he would still think that I am someone.
It kind of has to fit in, like, in their story, whatever the me story is going on.
Yeah, yeah.
Some people have talked about how sometimes they have experienced where the me has come back. There's no me, but after a while, the me has come back. Is it really possible? Because I feel like it would be kind of like going back into a shoebox after everything has kind of crumbled down.
Yes. Yeah, I know what you mean. I mean, at first, it's a story anyway. I mean, the presence of the me is a story. the falling away of the me is a story, and the coming of going of the me is a story. There is no such thing, basically. So, yes, it's a story. But it just seems to happen like that, yes, that there can be an absence of some kind, and that the sense to be someone comes back. Yes. My impression is that it has an impact in one's life. It's never really going back to how it was before. So for some people, this seems to have an impact in life, which can have all kinds of flavors. For some people, seeking becomes more intense afterwards, and it's a painful period. For some people, a lot of stress drops off and they feel go on more lightly afterwards. So it's not really predictable, but my impression is that it's hardly ever exactly the same as before, so to speak. It's not really going back to normal. And it's not really anyone's choice anyway. It's not the person who goes back to normal instead of going on living more non-dual, because it has seen that there is no one. So it's not the person going back and stuff like that. All of that would be just what happens without anyone's influence anyway.
Some of these stories can be very complicated. It's very interesting, like how subtle and complicated stories can become.
Of course. I mean, the thing is that in such a whole, reality itself gets shaken up, the sense of reality. So before that, it may be quite clear what's real and how the world is, and I'm here, and after that, this is kind of a bit shaken up at least. And then it can also, I don't know if you meant that, but then it can become quite, it can seem quite complicated and not clear anymore, and not clear what's real, what's right, what's wrong. So, yeah.
In your apparent story, did you have like some big changes in your views about certain things?
In my views about certain things?
Was there change in how you look at spirituality or how you look at religion?
Of course, totally. Of course. I mean, those changes happen within the story, or for the person, there can also be changes, of course, replacing of concepts or thinking that the church is a good thing, and then you see that they're also doing bad things. I mean, this doesn't necessarily have something to do with there being me or no me. But of course, I mean, this also happens when there is no person anymore, because then it's not one viewpoint replaced by another viewpoint. It's basically the collapse of viewpoints as reality. Oh, but of course, I mean, I was, for example, very convinced of the drugs thing, of the substances. I thought this is a very good lifestyle. And I was very disappointed when it all didn't work out as I thought. And the same happened with spirituality again. And of course, viewpoints about anything, basically. I had viewpoints about anything, relationship and money and job and about anything. In a way, the person has viewpoints about anything. It thinks it knows or at least it's close to knowing things. And of course, that all of that turned out to be empty. All viewpoints themselves turn out to be completely empty.
And it's interesting, like, how the me can intensify some of these views. It can make enlightenment really special, like something really big is going to happen, and it creates like so much, like even energy-wise and feeling-wise, it can create that imaginary intensity.
Yes, it gets high. It's high on those stories. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And it gets high and low on those stories. I'll be enlightened. There is enlightenment. I never get it. And stuff like that. Yes, it's amazing.
And it's really amazing. Like, it's living on those that imaginary intensity that it creates itself.
Totally, absolutely. In a way, one could almost say that's what it has. It creates this imaginary intensity and then takes it as a proof that it exists. Enlightenment, for example, or stuff. It's almost like it talks itself into it and afterwards believes it. That's true. It's amazing. It gets really high on it. Thinking, I am God. I'm God. I'm God. I'm really God. Yes, I already feel like God. And so that's the proof then for the person. Yeah.
It's really mind-blowing that.
Mm.
And when the weight of all those stories drops off, like it's like, yeah.
Yes, it's really a big, oh dear. Because that's the other side of the coin. Of course, one can talk oneself into I'm God, but it can't be held, it can't be kept. So usually, pretty quickly, there comes the crash of that. So the seeker, in a way, believes that it's there and it's possible, but as it crashes again and again, there's also the story, I'm not there yet. I still have to learn more. I still have to make progression. And this whole game is utterly exhausting. Utterly. It's artificial and it's exhausting.
Yeah, and now I can see, like, when Tony Parsons uses that the word contraction, that's a nice word to describe it, like that's the contraction that we don't realize when there's a person, that contraction created by all these imaginary concepts.
Yes, yeah. And yeah, the person lives in I am, and there comes a sense of, yeah, all those heaviness. There is an apparent heaviness around the person, of everything being real, and that there's a goal, it's about something and stuff like that. Yeah.
Is there anything particular you feel drawn to share today? And any?
Oh, I'm sorry. No. No, I don't have to share anything. That's the freedom, so to speak. There isn't anyone here who lives in a certain state or who has viewpoints or has found something that could be shared. No, absolutely not. No.
There's a lot of lightness to that.
Yes, absolutely. One could say everything being naturally itself is everything being very lightly itself. Yes. There was nothing to present. It's the same as what we just said with the things that the person talks itself into, those states, where it's always about one state. Liberation, enlightenment, oneness is when you feel like that. And I can share how I do that. I can share what's my method to have that one experience that I think enlightenment is. And that's a dream. That's a total dream. I don't have any of that. Basically, because there is no one in the first place. Basically, because exactly this one who is trying to do that turned out to be absolutely non-existent. It doesn't have any substance at all. That's freedom for no one, but that's the freedom.
I'm assuming like that kind of applies to even the current crisis that we are in.
Yeah, one could say so, yes, yeah. In that sense, it applies to everything because it's the natural reality. What we speak about is all of that. And in the end, what we speak about is this crisis too. It's this too. In that sense, it applies to everything. Not as a concept or stuff like that, but it is all of that.
Because the intensity of stories is strong right now. There are so many stories.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, the person, the sense to be someone is fascinated by intensity, but it's also threatened by it. Because it's quite obvious for the person that it's not really in control. So there's a strong need to invent stories and to escape into beliefs, apparently. All of that's apparent, of course. No one's doing that, but yes. Yeah.
Thank you, Andreas. This was really a lovely chat.
Nice to see you. Yeah, sorry.
If someone wants to find out about you, the timelesswonder.com is the website.
Exactly. Yes, that's my website. Yeah.
And now, are all your talks on Zoom or is there any plan for intensive?
I have some events in Germany, which are all in German, but unfortunately the other events had to be canceled. So I think there'll be Zoom meetings in English language, and the plans to travel again to abroad, to foreign countries seen from Germany, starts next year again. So next year there'll be intensives in English and my more or less regular, well, it was never really regular, but yes, the live meetings start again. That's the idea, so to speak. We'll see. But yes, there are Zooms.
Thank you.